Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school and not a church. And neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a non-profit, non-denominational, religious, and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh or Elohim and the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity until this present day. This school was established as a result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year of 1931. We were incorporated into the state of California in the year of 1958. Since that time, we have established branch schools throughout the United States and Canada and certain foreign countries. And the Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. Now, in this school, we teach according to the true and correct names and title for the Father, the Word, our Son, and the Holy Spirit as contained in the original Hebrew text. The true and correct name for the Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title for the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted by God. The name of the Holy Spirit manifested in or out of a physical body is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and 5 that there are Lord's many and God's many. But we now know each Lord must have a name, and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title. But unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good encyclopedia or dictionary will prove that neither the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin language have any letters or characters in their alphabet that will produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until 1400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and correct name of our Father and His Son. Christ is a title just like Lord and God. Now, Yahweh is pure spirit. And in this state, he is inscrutable and incomprehensible and indiscernible. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of all things. We have Yahweh in his pure spirit state, symbolized on this chart as a fiery cloud. Yahweh in pure spirit is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself, because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. Just as you see, this fiery cloud has been drawn to extend all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart abides within this cloud. In like manner, everything in the creation and the sum total of the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man cannot perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and form within himself as Elohim. This is the Word, our Son. A superincorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. This form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelation. Later on, this self-same spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now, there's only one name given unto salvation, and we must know that name. So the simple yet intelligent question we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name, entitled, may be had by reading the preface to the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called the divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of Egypt, he called Moses atop Mount Sinai and showed him the tabernacle pattern in a vision. He instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up your one tabernacle pattern. We go forth in this school to show proof how that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. The primary constitutional aims and objectives of the Institute are as follows. First is to help you find and know Yahweh, our Elohim, as it really is and actually exists. Second, to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah, without distinction of race or nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third, is to investigate the unexplained spirit law or the so-called laws of nature and the powers latent in man. Fourth, is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. Fifth, is to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth, is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seventh, is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons, operating a mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. Eighth, is to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith, which was once delivered unto the sons or children of Yahweh. Ninth, is to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained there is no other name given among men whereby a man can be saved, save in the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth, is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in a new earth state. Our watchword is peace, and our slogan is speak the truth. We'll have a prayer this morning by Dr. LeBron Hart, a scripture lesson of Isaiah, the 55th chapter, by Dr. Eunice Reiser, a selection of music. Turning on right there.
Yes, sir.
A second and tapping.
Good morning, class.
Good morning.
Let us all bow our hearts and minds in a moment of prayer. Heavenly Father Yahweh, thank you so much for all that you've given us. Father, we ask that you just bless us today. Open our hearts and minds and let us receive whatever message the speaker gets up on the floor and gives us. Father, let us understand that class is not just days on Sundays or on Tuesday nights. It's every day. Every day that you let us live is a day to learn more about your purpose, pattern, and plan, and see you in us. And all these blessings, we thank you and ask in your holy name, Yahshua Messiah. Let us all say,
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Good morning, class.
Good morning.
The scripture lesson will be taken from Isaiah, the 55th chapter, 55. And I'll be reading from the Holy Name Bible containing the Holy Name version of the Old and New Testament, critically compared with ancient authorities in various manuscripts, revised by the late A.B. Tremont, Scripture Research Association Incorporated. Isaiah 55. Ho, everyone that thirsteth, come ye to the waters, and he that hath no money, come ye, buy and eat. Ye come, buy wine and milk, without money and without price. Wherefore do ye spend money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which satisfieth not? Hearken diligently unto me, and eat ye that which is good, and let your soul delight itself in fatness. Incline your ear and come unto me. Hear, and your soul shall live, and I will make an everlasting covenant with you, even the sure mercies of David. Behold, I have given him for a witness to the people, a leader and commander to the people. Behold, thou shalt call a nation that thou knowest not, and nations that knew not thee shall run unto thee, because of Yahweh thy Elohim, and for the Holy One of Israel, for he hath glorified thee. Seek ye Yahweh while he may be found. Call ye upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts, and let him return unto Yahweh, and he will have mercy upon him, and to Elohim, for he will abundantly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, saith Yahweh. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. For as the rain cometh down, and the snow from heaven, and returneth not thither, but watereth the earth, and maketh it bring forth, and bud, that it may give seed to the sower, and bread to the eater. So shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth. It shall not return unto me void, but it shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the things whereunto I sent it. For ye shall go out with joy and be led forth with peace. The mountains and the hills shall break forth before you into singing, and all the trees of the field shall clap their hands. Instead of the thorn shall come up the fir tree, and instead of the briar shall come up the myrtle tree, and it shall be to Yahweh for a name, for an everlasting sign that shall not be cut off. I have read the 55th chapter of Isaiah. Let us all say hallelujah.
Our first speaker this morning will be the dean of the school, Dr. Joe Williams.
Good morning, class.
Good morning.
It's always a pleasure and an honor to stand before the city of Yahshua Messiah and testify as some of the things that Yahweh allowed to see, understand and see about this great teaching. Before I get into my discourse here, I just want to, I am just happy to see my son and my grandson here. This is just three generations here of this teaching. And I just hope and aspire that going forth that we continue to create new memories as we proceed and sojourn this body. I'm going to try to collect myself here and get through this, but I'm very happy inside my heart and my soul and my spirit to see them. Now, before I go on, I want one other thing I want to say. Today is so-called Easter. And what we've done is we've corrupted our children with this thing we call Easter. Now, somebody can explain to me, it doesn't make me no difference who it is. What does chicken eggs have to do with Easter? What does coloring eggs have to do with Easter or the resurrection? Now, while we run around, we teaching our kids that, making them think that rabbits lay eggs. This is what we do. This is what we do, and this is what we've done. Now, I don't have no problem with purple, green, pink, orange, yellow eggs. I think they taste relatively good. I like the eggs. But my point is, what we've done is we've corrupted the minds of our children and making them think that that chickens lay eggs, and that when Easter comes, which is the resurrection, guess what? We're gonna go on an Easter egg hunt, we're gonna do this, this is what we do. And that's a deception. You know, that's a deception that we have created. Now, our founder, Dr. Henry Clifton Kennedy, said he had divine vision or revelation direct from Yahweh himself. And he said, don't believe it because I said it, but make me prove it to your satisfaction. And what he also said was this. He wanted us to know this, that you're Yahweh. You see, he says, I'm Yahweh, so are you. The only difference is I'm conscious of it and you're not. And I'm endeavoring to bring you up to that understanding. Now today what I'm going to do is lay a very solid foundation because we have a lot of new folks that's in the class. and do not fully understand how to line these scriptures up. And I made a declaration that I'm going to spend some time doing that and not try to mix, how can I say it? I'm going to boil meat with milk. And that's pretty much what I'm going to do. And make sure that we all get fed. Those have been here for a while and those have been here for a short time. Now, 1 Corinthians 15:1 and 1 John 5:7-8. Now, this is the definition. This is the definition of what the gospel is. You see, now prior to coming to the school, I had no clue about what the gospel was other than jumping up and down, turning flips, and doing all these things. That's what I thought the gospel was. All right. But I found out that the gospel have an absolute definition, you see, which we're going to read over here in 1 Corinthians 15:1. Now, the Corinthians, this was a group of people that loved the party. There were some very, very, very wealthy people, very similar to Las Vegas, you see. So they were very wealthy, and they had a lot of money, you see, and had a good time. And the Apostle Paul went there, and he spoke to them, and he preached to them. But when Paul left, you see, there became a division among the assembly. One person was looking at this flesh, another person was looking at that personality, and next thing there was confusion among the assembly. So Paul wrote this letter, and the letter that he wrote, what we're going to read right now, is the letter to the Corinthians. And this is one of the things that he said. Read on.
Moreover, brethren.
Now, moreover means on top of what I already told you. Read.
I declare unto you the glad tidings.
Now, I need you to read it with, I need the gospel. Because I think that's what it said. But you got, what you got, King James Version? Yeah.
No, it says glad tidings. King James.
The Holy Name.
It's the gospel. See, the gospel and the glad tidings mean the same thing. Mm-hmm. However, when you see the word gospel, I think I spelled that right, right? Did I spell that right?
No H.
Take the H
out. E-L. Yeah. The gospel. That word means the good news. That's what gospel means. You see, or the glad tidings. You see, so we want to hear the good news. Read, please.
I declare unto you the gospel, yes, which I preached unto you.
Read.
Which also ye have received.
Read.
And wherein ye stand.
Read.
By which also ye are saved, if ye keep in memory what, excuse me, if ye keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless ye have believed in vain.
So you have to keep in memory whatever you learn. It's the same thing as, you know, you learn to play the piano, all right? You've been practicing for a whole year, now it's time to perform at the recital. And then you don't know squat because you don't understand, you know, the keys, you have your technique, and you forgot your technique, you see? You get my point? But you gotta keep in memory. If you become a nurse, you gotta learn the basic fundamental principles of nursing, right, that when it's time for you to execute your craft, you should be able to do it, whatever it may be. Take a temperature, whether it's do a blood pressure, but you got to be able to do it right and accurate so you can give an accurate assessment to whoever you're giving that information to. But you got to keep it in memory, all right? Same thing with this teaching. You see, what we're doing is this. We're trying to resurrect your soul, because when we was born psychologically and spiritually dead, meaning we didn't know who we were. You see, we don't know where we come from, what the creation is. We didn't know anything about that. Only thing we understand is that we are hungry and didn't understand that or where it was going to come from. You see, but what we want to do is take off all this flesh, come out of this darkness, and come into the glorious light of Yahshua Messiah and stand and be a soldier for Yahshua Messiah. Let's read.
For I delivered unto you first of all that which I received.
Read on.
How that Yahshua died for our sins.
Read on.
According to the scriptures.
Read on.
And that he was buried and that he rose again the third day according to the scriptures.
Now listen. Now this is what he said. Third verse, read it again.
For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received.
Uh-huh.
How they got
hold it. How? That's a big word. How? That Yahshua did what?
Died.
Hold it. He died. Come on.
For our sins.
Uh-huh.
According to the scriptures.
According to the scriptures. Read.
And that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the scriptures.
Is it two R's in resurrection? Two R's. Mm-hmm. I missed my C?
Yep.
Oh, got it. Only all that. This is good enough right there. All right. Resurrection. I think that's it, right?
There's two R's, but it's okay.
That's two R's.
We understand what you're saying.
Right. There you go.
All right. How he died, how he buried, and how he resurrected the third day. Right. According to the scriptures.
Right. Right.
Not what Pastor so-and-so said, or what you heard, but according to the scriptures. Now, let's define what the scriptures are. Isaiah 8:20. And don't forget 1 John 5, 7, and 8. Let's read, please.
First.
Isaiah, we're going to pick up Isaiah 8:20, and then we're going to go to 1 John 5, 7, 8, King James Version.
Isaiah 8:20. To the law and to the testimony.
Read.
If they speak not according to this word, it is because there is no light in them.
Okay, to the law and to the testimony. The testimony is the same thing as the prophet. Now you know the law, the first five books of your Bible, and the testimony or the prophets of the next 34 books of your Bible, which comprise of what they call the Old Covenant or the Old Testament, from Genesis on down in Revelation, I mean to Malachi. That make up what we call the scriptures. And at that particular time, when the Messiah was walking around the Palestine Judean hills, they did not have Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and the Pauline epistles, and the book of Revelation. That had not yet been written. That was written some 20 to 30 years after Yahshua's death and his burial and his resurrection. So then we have to go back and search what they had at that particular time. So what we're after is Yahshua's death, his burial, and his resurrection. That is according to the scriptures, whatever Moses said and what the prophet said. You see, because what's written in the law is confirmed by the prophet.
That's right.
And what's in the prophet is confirmed by the law. You see, was Yahshua Messiah going to come along, and what he's going to do, he's going to fulfill that which is written in the law and in the testament or in the prophet. Y'all with me so far? Mm-hmm. Now, let's read 1 John 5, 7, 8.
1 John 5, 7, 8, King James. For there are three that bear record in heaven.
Now, there's three that bear record in heaven. Read on.
The Father.
Read.
The Word.
Read.
And the Holy Spirit.
Read on.
And these three are one.
Now, it says the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit, these three are one.
Right.
That is an immutable, indelible record that's in heaven.
That's right.
What do you mean immutable? It means that it's unchangeable. You see, what do you mean indelible? It's permanent. In other words, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit, and these three are one, that is an immutable, indelible record, and it does not change.
That's right.
For you and your carnal mind.
Mm-hmm.
All right? Let's read.
And there are three that bear witness in earth.
Then there's three that bear witness in earth. Read on.
The Spirit.
That's the Spirit.
And the water.
And the water.
And the blood.
And the blood.
And these three agree in one.
It did not say these three are one.
Right.
It says these three agree in one. Everybody in here have blood in their body. They have water in their body, and they have spirit. If you lose any one of these, of course, you are a dead man, and you have no business being up in here. But these are the witnesses that is on the earth. And your body is an earthen vessel, so therefore, you got the spirit, the water, and the blood as a witness that you are a creature, you see, and you have been created, you see, and you are a witness right within yourself. Let's read, please.
If we receive the witness of men,
read.
The witness of God is greater.
Read on, please.
For it is the witness of God which hath testified of his Son.
Read on.
He that believeth on the Son of God.
Oh, that's good enough right there with the
King James.
Yeah. Okay. I just wanted to get that part in there about the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, these three in one. Go ahead. Now switch over and translate that for me.
Okay.
You can still read, but just translate.
He that believeth on Yahweh, on the Son of Yahweh, has a witness in himself.
Now, if you believe on the Son of Yahweh, simply, you got the witness within yourself, which is already documented. Let's read.
He that believeth not Yahweh,
read,
hath made him a liar.
Read on.
Because he believeth not the record of Yahweh's Son of Gabriel. Let me start that over. Because he believeth not the record that Yahweh gave of his Son.
Read on.
And this is the record that Yahweh have given to us.
Read.
Eternal life and this life in his Son.
That's good enough right there. Now, what is eternal life? John 17 and 3.
John 17:3.
Now here's the Messiah. And he's talking. Alright? Read, please.
And this is life eternal.
Read.
That they might know.
Read.
That thou only art the true El, and Yahshua the Messiah, whom thou hast sent.
Now, eternal life is to know. Not think, not imagine. It's to know. That what? Read.
And this is eternal, this is life eternal, that they might know that thou only art the true El.
That thou art the only true Elohim.
And Yahshua the Messiah.
And Yahshua Messiah, whom thou hast sent. That's what eternal life. That's the definition of eternal life. Now, we already talked about the gospel. It is the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Yahshua Messiah.
That's right.
That's what the gospel is. So what we're going to do, I put this on the board so you can understand that when you see the word death is lining up with the blood. When you see blood, the principle is death. When you see death, you're going to see something relative to blood. Burial, that is water. All right? When you see the water, that's the principle of a burial. You see, when you see burial, it's pointing to the water. All right? Resurrection, that is spirit. Yeah, that's spirit. So when you see the resurrection, that is pointing to spirit. Because our pattern dictate that there is a spirit. And if you got these basic fundamental principles down, then you're going to be fine. Now, we also understand this, that Yahshua Messiah, when he came around walking around the Palestine, Judea, and Hill, you see, there is something that he told us to do. That is John 5 and 39. Let's read, please. I'm being plain for a few minutes here. So I want to make sure everybody understands what we're talking about down here.
John 5 and 39.
Now, this is the Messiah walking around in one of these physical bodies, and this is one of the things he said. Read on.
Ye search the scriptures.
Read.
For in them ye think ye have eternal life.
Uh-huh.
And they are they which testify of me.
Now what happened at that particular time, the Sanhedrin council, the Pharisees, the scribes, the Essenes, the Zealots, all these folks were running around here talking about this man like a dog. Because as far as they was concerned, that was Joseph and Mary's boy. They had no idea that that was God. You see, in a body, walking around, healing the sick, calling the blind to see, the dumb to speak, and the deaf to hear. They didn't get that. You see, only thing they were concerned about was this Mosaic law that they was under, which were carnal ordinances, and I'm talking about 613 statutes, judgments, and ordinances that these people had to adhere to. They thought that was the law. You see, and if they did that, they thought they would have salvation. You see, and here he comes, he said, now listen, you search the scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life, but the scriptures are talking about me. Let's read, please.
But ye will not come to me that ye might have life.
Read.
I receive not honor from men.
In other words, he don't need no accolades.
you know, like pat on the back or, you know, rubbing on the head or all these conversations about we have Dr. So-and-so from so-and-from this university. He don't need all that. Mm-hmm. You see, he already knew that he was the creator of heaven and earth. Let's read.
But I know you.
He says, I know your thought, your motivation, and your intent. Why? Because I created you. Read, please.
That ye have not the love of Elohim in you.
You have not the love of Elohim in you. Read, please.
I am come in my Father's name.
Now listen, he says, I come in my Father's name. Read on.
And you receive me not.
Now the Father's name is Yahweh. Now we drive this home. If you don't get the name straight, you don't get nothing straight. The name is Yahweh, you see. And Yahweh is both masculine and feminine within himself. He does not have to go outside of himself to create or to procreate. Yahweh within himself is made up of these attributes of intelligence, wisdom and knowledge, beauty, love, justice, foundation, power, and strength. This is what he is, yet he abides therein. The moderator said this. He said that Yahweh chose to symbolize himself as a cloud. He is not a cloud. He just chose the cloud to represent himself because it has no particular or descriptive shape and form. He also said that this cloud extends all around the edges of this chart to show you how that everything in the universe, and when we say universe, we're talking about the angelic physical, the angelic creation, as well as the physical creation. The two makes up the universe. Most people, when they think of the universe, they just think of the physical part. But they don't understand there's two counterparts. That is the spirit realm or the angelic realm and, of course, the physical creation itself. Yahweh Elohim himself is the manifestation of the angelic and the physical. Have Romans 1:19 and 20. Hold them for me in just a second. And if you see here, you have a physical body that you walk around in. And I'm going to tell you this. You are a miniature construction of the universe. You see, and when I say that, you have an inner man, but you also have a physical body. And when this inner man says move, the physical body moves. The physical body don't say move, and also the inner man says I'm going to follow. The dictates always come from the inner man.
That's right.
Because that is Yahweh Elohim himself leading and guiding you and communicating and processing the information that's within your consciousness. He knows when you see it, he knows when you don't see it. He knows when you err, he knows when you don't err. You understand what I'm saying? But nevertheless, that is him. Nevertheless, everything, you see, abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh, or the angelic and the physical, which is the universe, abides within the invisible third part of Yahweh, which is spirit law. You walk around this physical body, you abide within the pure spirit state of Yahweh, which is the invisible third part, which is spirit law. This is spirit law. Remember, Yahweh is spirit. I think I had that read the other night. Just pick it up real quick, 2 Corinthians 3rd chapter, and just read it. And then when you get it. So Yahweh is spirit. He both master and figure within himself. Doesn't have to go outside of himself to create or to procreate. He is equipped within himself to give birth to his son, which is Yahweh Elohim, or Yahweh incarnated as Elohim, or Yahweh incarnated as Yahweh Elohim, or as the son of Yahweh. This shape and form is the archetype or the original pattern of the universe. Now let's get this straight and understood. Yahweh is not over here and the shape and form is over there. Mm-hmm. And it sounds like it because that's where we teach it. And it looks like he's over here and Elohim is over there. You see? And then next thing you know, then we say, and the word was made flesh, and we got 1, 2, 3 separate entities. And I'm trying to get you to see, this is Moses caught up on the mountain here. You see, and he's having a vision and a revelation of Yahweh Elohim. And he is seeing how these attributes of intelligence, wisdom, knowledge, beauty, love, justice, foundation, power, strength, which is your very essence. It is your divine makeup. It is the very essence and the makeup of who you are. This is Yahweh's makeup. Likewise, it is your makeup. And let me say this. You see, Yahweh is not only intelligence, he is the source of intelligence, the source of wisdom, the source of knowledge, beauty, love, justice, foundation, power, and strength. And there is nothing that precedes or that is pre-existent of Yahweh or pure spirit. Why? Because Yahweh is eternal. You cannot get outside of him to look back on him. Why? Just as you can't get outside of yourself to look back on yourself. You follow what I'm saying? Because Yahweh has no beginning. And he has no ending. Can we comprehend the vastness of this creator that we're talking about? That has no beginning and has no ending, yet he's all in all. You understand what I'm talking about? So therefore, I'm trying to get you to see you cannot get something from nothing. Nevertheless, Yahweh is the ultimate source, the immaculate substance, the limit, the bounds, and the origin and the essence of all things, including you. You see, and we're trying to get you to understand your origin, your start place, your beginning, so you can become conscious of your very own immortality. Each one of these attributes are beyond the possibility of death because it is immortality personified.
That's right.
So therefore, if Yahweh Elohim is immortality personified, I'm trying to get you to see this is him in his ontological state of perfection or within his pure spirit state, you see, or within his abstract state. And in this state and condition, talking about his pure spirit state, this is pure creativity, infinite possibilities, pure potentiality, that is in the abstract state, if you will. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Now, Yahweh knew and understand, you're not going to understand him in his abstract state. So it behooved him to come down into a lesser state. And he did that out of love for you, knowing that you would not understand him in his ontological state of perfection or in his abstract state. So he come down into a lesser state, which is the Word. You see, which we're going to get that in just a second, which is John 1 and 1. Have that holding for me too. I know I got two holding right now, right?
Right.
Okay, so these attributes took on an organized shape form as Elohim. Nevertheless, I want you to clearly see that Yahweh is spirit, is both masculine and feminine within himself. Now, let me say this before I move forward from the Father. He knew you're not going to understand him in this state. So what does he do? He creates a man on the sixth day, and he calls him Adam. Right?
Yeah.
One vow repeated twice. Got to have two witnesses. You see? That's the masculine portion of the man. All right? Then he creates a woman. Her name is Eve. All right? One vow repeated twice. Right?
Yeah.
Now, I'll say it like this. This is English. The Jehovah's Witness say nobody knows the placements of the name Yahweh.
Right.
This is Hebrew. I don't speak Hebrew. But I recognize that this is Hebrew. YHWH. That's what that is. All right? Now, if you do it in Hebrew, it's going to look like this. It's going to be YHWH. All right? Now, in that the A would be, H in this case would be silent. It's clear. The question is right within his name to ask why.
Right.
Because you know people say, well, don't, you ask the pastor a question. He don't know the answer. He's thinking, girl, don't be messing God's business now. You know, I call that laundering the money. You know what I mean? You know how you ask somebody a question. You love me? You know I know you. I love your whole family. I didn't ask you if I love your whole family. I asked you, do you love me? I love the whole family, girl. Now he just laundered the money.
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying? You know, that's what they do.
Yeah.
So what I'm trying to get you to see is that within, we speak English. So therefore, we left to right.
No.
They're right to left.
Yeah.
So YHWH. Now, within that name, we cannot pronounce these letters because we need vowels in our language.
Mm-hmm.
Now, your argument with a Jehovah's Witness, they're going to say this. We have to transliterate the name. Okay, meaning that you get the same sound, you see, in the same language. That makes sense. In other words, when we take the name, the vowels out of Adam, we put that in the masculine portion of the name. You see, you get Yah. You take Eve, take the E out of Eve, you put that in the feminine portion of the name. You give way. It's really just that simple. Mm-hmm. Now everybody know that the dominant hormone in the woman is estrogen. Is that correct? Yeah. And we know the dominant hormone in the man is androgen. All right? Now, if you just look at the title of name, you're going to get the man before the woman. You follow me? Just in the title. My point is, it's not a coincidence. Yahweh is sending right. these witnesses and these clues for you to look at. Right. So you can come to an understanding of who you are. You see? That's what this is all about. You see? So the name is Yahweh, and Yahweh is Spirit. Now he's coming down into a lesser state for you to understand him. But in that, now you have a male and a female. So when I say the name is Yahweh, what you going to argue about? You going to say it's Jehovah? And let me tell you something. I don't really want to get into it. I'm just going to say this. The moderator already said the J is only 400 years old. And it came to existence 1,400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, there is no J. There is no Jesus, no Jehovah. And let me tell you something. There is no James. You see, there is no John either. Because you know people always say, well, what about James and John? Well, there is no salvation in John. And there is no salvation in James. And there is no salvation in Jerusalem. However, they were I's and Y's. But they were not J's. And the true Jews, that's when we say Jew, it's like calling I'd be nice today. It's like calling a Japanese a Jap. You follow me? And they accept that. Or Chinese, a chink. You see what I mean? But what I'm trying to get you to see in essence, is Yahuda, Yahuda. All right? And it's right here on the chart. It's right here on the chart. I-N-R-I. It's written in Hebrew, Greek, and Latin. Okay? Mm-hmm. That's what the Jews are. We call them Jews, but they're Yahudis. Hebrews, Israelites, sons of Jacob. That's what they are. But they accepted you because y'all are comfortable with it. We just respond to it. You know, just like they should say, you colored people, we just respond to it. You colored folks get all over here. Now, don't say I ain't colored, don't get over there. You just walk your butt on over there. Otherwise, they're going to put a nice little hurt on you. Mm-hmm. Now, today, you might think twice about it. You might get a little tough. And depending on who says it, where you are, you better walk right on over there. You get what I'm saying? So the point I'm trying to, this is him. You see, Yahshua is Nazareth, King of the Jews, written in Hebrew, Greek, and Latin. You see, now, I hope I got that straight about pure spirit. Now, Yahweh incarnated as Elohim. That means he took on shape and form, or he transmuted into a spirit embodiment of a man. That's Elohim, which is the Word or Son. Talking about the shape and form here. It is a spirit embodiment of a man. Let me say it like this here. You got John for me yet, boss?
John 1:1.
Please, por favor.
In the beginning was the Word.
Now look. It says, in the beginning was the Word. I ain't going over here. I went over here. Right. In the beginning, before the creation came in.
Right.
All right? Mm-hmm. And why you had to pick up Proverbs 8:20. Okay? In the beginning was the Word. Read on.
And the Word was with Yahweh.
This Word, listen, follow the stick. It was with Yahweh, the ultimate source and the substance of all things. Read on.
And the Word was Yahweh.
This same Word in shape and form, it was Yahweh incarnated. All right, let's read.
The same was in the beginning with Yahweh.
This same Word was encouched within the midst of the cloud before it appeared, come from behind the veil of inscrutability. In other words, I'll get this in a minute. In other words, Yahweh purposed and declared a purpose right with himself that is in the abstract state. But when Yahweh Elohim appeared within the cloud, or when Yahweh took on shape and form, Yahweh Elohim himself was an execution of the purpose. Or he was a declaration of the purpose, or he was a declaration of what Yahweh declared back here in the realm of eternity. In other words, he just moved because spirit moves. You see? But in this state, it looked like nothing's going on. But when he set his purpose in motion, it was Yahweh, or these attributes, that took on shape and form as Elohim or Yahweh Elohim. But he was still the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit in an abstract state. He is still the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, that is, in an incorporeal state. No loss of power. He just moved from, I'll say it like this, he just transmuted from the abstract into the incorporeal. Okay? Or from pure spirit into a spirit embodiment without flesh, bone, or blood. That's Yahweh Elohim. So when they write the aim, he says this, to help you find and know Yahweh our Elohim.
Right.
You see? Mm-hmm. Not pure spirit, but Elohim as he really is and as he actually exists. Because this is the creator state, and now he's going to carry out the will of the Father. So therefore, now, it says, I come in my Father's name. So when you read the name right here, that's what we were, right? I come in my Father's name. This is a contracted form of Yahweh in salvation. Shua means salvation. You see, that's all it is. Yahweh is salvation. But this is the Son of Yahweh, or Yahweh, in a sonship degree, carrying out the will of what he purposed and declared there. So I'll come in my Father's name, you receive it not. Let another come in his own name, him you will receive. Let's read. Man, I ain't got nowhere. Read, please.
All things were made by him.
It didn't say some thing was made by Yahweh. It says all things that include you was made by Yahweh. Let's read.
And without him was not anything made that was made.
Without Yahweh taking on shape and form as Elohim, the creation wouldn't be here. Let's read, please.
In him was life.
In him was life. Talking about Elohim. Read on.
And the life was the light of men.
And the life was the light of men because it was Yahweh Elohim that took a residence, that is, in Adam and in all of us. All right? It was no devil taking up residence in you, making you act a fool.
Right.
I want to make that perfectly clear.
That's right.
You act a fool because when you get here, you see, you develop. Yeah, I said that?
Right.
You develop a carnal mind.
Exactly.
See, at some point in time, all of a sudden you feel you can walk. You can follow me. You want everybody, you know how we do. All this, you know. You laugh, hey, the kids say, oh yeah. They start walking again, fogging. Who taught them that? You didn't teach them that.
Right.
The spirit in them taught them how to walk.
That's right.
How to suckle. You see, how to get your attention. You see? So as they get older, they found out they can manipulate you. Mm-hmm. They don't understand what manipulate means.
Right.
But they know how to do it.
Mm-hmm.
And next thing you know, the kids realize they start walking around. I don't feel like going to the bathroom. Next thing you know, stuff starts sliding all down the leg. You know what I'm talking about? You walk around smelling like a doggone billy goat, got loaded with a diaper, you know what I mean? Y'all anything about that? Y'all try to take it off. You know what I mean? Hey, that's how they, and why did you want to take your own dog? See, the reason why I don't have no dog, my son though, I don't want to clean up no doggone poop.
You're right.
I don't want to take him to the doggone vet. I'll take him to get shots. But I ain't going to take him to get shots. So I don't need no dog. Right? Now y'all have a dog, I got a dog. As long as you got a dog, I got a dog. But that's you. I love animals, just I don't want to take care of them. So I ain't got no business having no dog, right? You'd be starved for a few days, because on some day I may not be home for a day or two. You better make do. My point is, you see, because of that carnality, which is that egotistical misdirected personality that we develop by being absorbed, listen, into the world. And that's what caused us to have problems within ourselves and with each other. All right? Now, finish reading. In the beginning, with the Word, the Word was with Yahweh, the Word was Yahweh. All things was made by him, without anything made that was made. In him was life, and life, and he was the light of men. Let's read.
And the light shineth in darkness.
Now look, This don't look like no light bulb now, does it?
Mm-mm. Right.
We're talking about principles. The principle is that it's Him that's animating your body.
Right.
Causing you to move and have your beings, that is, in Him. Let's read.
And the darkness comprehended it not.
Now, in that Yahweh is made up of these attributes. An attribute is a basic fundamental principle of mankind. In you, you have intelligence, wisdom, knowledge, beauty, love, justice, foundation, power, strength, hope, joy, peace in that body. That's what right. You got in there. That's what I'm talking to.
Mm-hmm.
Your essence, your being, not this right here.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't have this in here, we're going to call somebody to come get you up out of here. You see? That's what we're communicating with. These attributes, you see, is what you is the light. It's the light. Let's read.
14th verse. And the Word was made flesh.
And the Word was made flesh. All right? Read.
And dwelt among us. And we beheld His glory and the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth.
I almost said, if it ain't God, don't answer it. Anyway, let's move on. And the Word was made flesh, right? Read on.
John bear witness.
Oh, that's good enough right there. I just want to make that point. And the Word and the Word was made flesh, meaning that Yahweh is in two manifestations. Don't get this wrong. He's pure spirit, incorporeal, incorporeal. You with me so far?
Yes.
He's one spirit in two manifestations. Incorporeal, incorporeal. Invisible, invisible. Mm. That's how it is. All right? I'm being real plain today. All right?
Mm-hmm.
Now, with that being said, let's go ahead and pick up Romans 1:19 and 20. And then I want to go to Matthew 13 chapter. And then we can move forth.
Don't forget Proverbs.
Oh, you know what? He said Proverbs. He's right. Let me have Proverbs first before I move forward. Then I get back.
You want
8 and 20?
8 and 20.
How about 8 and 22?
8 and 22.
Read.
Yahweh possessed me in the beginning of His way.
Now hold it right there. We have a tendency to read over that. What is the beginning of His way? When Yahweh took on shape and form. This is the beginning of His way.
Yeah.
Okay? Yahweh possessed me in the beginning of His way, before I assembled a creation by the pattern.
Mm-hmm.
Read, please.
Before His works of old.
This is His works of old right here, what you're sitting on. Let's read.
I was set up from everlasting.
Go ahead, read.
From the beginning or ever the earth was.
Go ahead.
When there was no depth,
read.
I brought forth.
Go ahead.
When there was no fountain abounding with water.
Read on, please.
Before the mountains were settled.
Read.
Before the hills I brought forth.
Mm-hmm.
While as yet He had not made the earth.
Read.
Nor the fields, nor the highest part of the dust of the world.
Now this is Solomon writing about Yahweh Elohim. This ain't Solomon writing about Solomon.
That's right.
Right.
He's writing about Yahweh Elohim. When He appeared within the cloud or come from behind the veil of inscrutability. And then it was in this state, he's in the creator state or in the I will be state, and Moses witnessed or saw a rerun how the creation came in by the pattern. And what Moses saw, you see, how the light was separated from the darkness, the twilight, the mist on the first day. On the second day, the waters above and the water beneath with the firmament, the mist. On the third day, the waters rolling off the face of the deep, the seed of vegetation coming on into the bud state and on into fruition. On the fourth day, put the sun, moon, and the stars and the seasons in position. On the fifth day, the birds of the heaven, the fish and the sea, and those animals that cohabitate on land and water. This is what Moses is seeing as he's caught up in the vision. And then he sees the man who's made spirit, soul, and body, and how the Yahweh Elohim took up residence in the man as He formed him, that is, from the dust of the earth. Why dust? Dust is the finer particles of the earth, and it's likened to pure spirit. There's dust in the room. You don't see it, but it's a type of pure spirit. Not for the Saturday morning, we're watching cartoons. And the sun coming through, we can see that dust in that light. right? You look above it, you don't see squat. You look below it, don't see nothing. But you see the movement of that dust. That's what you were made out of, the finer particles of the earth. Nevertheless, you see, that's what he made the man of, because he is pure spirit, or he is incomprehensible, inscrutable, and indiscernible. Nevertheless, you see, the man is both masculine and feminine within himself, because a woman was encountered within him. How do I know that? Because Yahweh is both masculine and feminine within himself.
Right.
We got a pattern going for.
Right.
So if he's both masculine and feminine, therefore when Yahweh Elohim appears in the cloud, he has to be both masculine and feminine within himself as he's manifested the creation all the way down.
Mm-hmm.
All right? Now, the first day, you got to see that same masculine and feminine expression manifested on day, first day. The life and the darkness of the twilight. The light will be likened to the masculine expression. The twilight will be likened to the feminine expression. Make sense? Second day, the waters above and the water beneath. You see, there's raging waters, like the rapids.
Right.
You see? Or the real big heaping tides that I would never get on. And then you got those nice little small neat ties when you're walking down the beach, hold your girl's hand, you see, and that water's just trickling, and all of a sudden you got the gift of gab like you never had before. You start saying things you probably wouldn't have said on the way in the car. You follow what I'm saying? That's nice, smooth hip ties. Hitting that water, hypnotize you, making you feel all good. So sometimes we may try to emulate that at home. We buy one of those little small little make-believe, you know what I'm talking about, the make-believe
waterfall.
Yeah, you think you got a waterfall, they live right. You know, just to get the sound, it's kind of like, you know, hypnotizes, gets us in that nice, calm us down. You know what I mean? You know what I'm talking about. So, my point is masculine, feminine. And of course, with the Botany Kingdom, which is the plant kingdom, you have masculine, feminine. And of course, you know, on the sun, you see, masculine, you see, and the stars, you see, is feminine. The moon has no light of her own. Is that correct?
Right.
It gets its light from the sun, you see. And then, so you got masculine, you got feminine. And then, of course, in the animal kingdom, the birds, you see, and the animals that cohabitate on land and water, of course, the beasts and the fish, they all are masculine and feminine. My point, you got to see that coming all the way down as Yahweh is manifesting himself and declaring himself on earth. And of course, you got the man who is both masculine and feminine within himself.
Mm-hmm.
You with me so far?
Mm-hmm.
Let's read, finish that up in Romans 1, 19 and 20, because I ain't got nowhere. Let's read.
When he prepared the heavens,
read.
I was there when he set
go
the
ahead.
Compass
mm-hmm.
on the face of the depth.
Go ahead.
When he established the cloud above.
Read.
When he strengthened the fountain of the deep.
Go ahead.
When he gave to the sea its decree.
Come on.
That the water should not pass his commandment.
Read.
When he appointed the fountains of the earth.
Read.
Then I was by him as one brought up with him. And I was daily his delight.
That's good enough right there. I just want to make that real clear. You see, that Yahweh brought this thing in. And everything you see after Yahweh Elohim is a reflection or a manifestation in him. Him being threefold and how he himself, talking about Yahweh, operates by the pattern. What is the pattern? The pattern is the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit in an abstract state. You can't see that. So he takes on shape and form. He is still the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit in an incorporeal state and condition. You can't see that unless Yahweh gives you permission or allows you to see him or is revealed. But then he manifests into every cosmographical structure of the universe, including you. So therefore, if he was threefold here in the abstract and incorporeal, he has to be that in the physical. So the founder said this, it takes the natural to understand the spiritual.
Right.
That's what he said. But it takes the spirit to declare the natural. Did you get that?
Yeah.
It started first in the spirit.
Right.
But since you are carnal,
yeah.
You see,
mm-hmm.
corrupt,
mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah,
corrupt.
Yeah.
I ain't say you was a thief or a robber. But, you know, what I'm saying by corrupt, we believe that rabbits lay eggs.
Yeah.
And somehow, rabbits have something to do with Easter. And if anybody can explain that to me, I'll give you the floor. You know, but that's what we do. And listen, all these pagan holidays, we all get up for, you know what I mean? And listen, they know how to lure us in and keep us right there, because they keep feeding our flesh and feeding our flesh and feeding our flesh. And I'm not talking about this. I'm talking about your life, your desires, whatever you want, whatever makes you feel good, whatever gets you off, whatever. That's what he does.
Right.
What I mean, I'm talking about the adversary. Now let me say this before I move on. The devil. I'm trying to hit it before I leave. See, the devil is no more than a direct antithesis of these attributes, meaning that it's the opposite. You see, the opposite of love is hate, the opposite of beauty is being ugly, you know what I mean? You see, foundation, weakness, you get what I'm saying? You see, intelligence, I mean, I'll say knowledge, you're dumb, you, it's just the opposite. Or stupidity. You get my point?
Much better.
It's just the opposite. Light, darkness. So, these attributes that you have within you, they're in you. But what happened because of the world, we absorbed in it. Meaning this is your image. This is who you are, and this is who you become. You see? Because after the fall of Adam, you see, he has the babies. Cain was the first one. You see, I'm letting you know. He was born, and listen, it was the satanic spirit, Lucifer, who incarnated in Cain. You see, which I ain't gonna get into today. But the point is that Cain went up and built a city, and that was the first. I'll say, this is the original capital of the earth, the city of Enoch. And then you got the second Babylonian Empire, which was six generations from, of course, Enoch. You follow me? That was Nimrod. You see, and Nimrod built a tower. You see, and when the tower came tumbling down, guess what? Those folks scattered to the four corners of the earth. You with me so far?
Right.
And then you got the second Babylonian Empire, you see, which is Nebuchadnezzar and his boys, and they were conquered by the Medes and the Persians. You see, Darius, Artaxerxes, you see, and Cyrus, I believe. All right? That's who that was. You see, they conquered him. And then they got conquered by Alexander the Great. My point is, these kingdoms are coming down, and they are changing, you see, from the city of Enoch over to the Tower of Babel. That was a change. To Nebuchadnezzar, to the Medes, to the Persians, to Alexander the Great. Of course, you got pagan Rome, which are the Caesars, and then you have papal Rome, which is still going on right now within the Catholic Church. And let me say this about the Catholic Church. The Catholic Church is on every continent, save Antarctica. And maybe there too.
Really?
I ain't visited none of it.
Yeah.
They're on every continent. They're in every state, every province, every county, every city, every town. There's a Catholic Church, folks.
Yeah.
And they're one of the richest organizations I'm talking about on the globe. And I tell you who's catching up with them. Are the Mormons. Them some rich folks too. I mean, you get my point? But my point is, we have been absorbed into that world. Now, if the papacy is still going on, the reason we got Protestantism, because they protest against the Protestant church. Y'all with me so far? And all of the churches, you see, the papacy is the mother of every last one of them.
Right.
You see? Now, what we have to do is recognize what it is we're dealing with, and come out of Babylon. Now you got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 world dynasties or kingdoms. And the book of Revelation, we ain't gonna get to talk about the 8th, which is Mystery Babylon. What we're doing down here is trying to get you out of Mystery Babylon, that way you can step outside of it and look at all this corruption that's going on and realize the reality of it. Like, for example, LeBron said to me today, he said, man, am I still going to get my lecture today? He said, oh, you going to tell it's going to be you, because you know today's Easter, right? Now, as far as we're concerned, it's just freaking Sunday.
Right. Yes.
It's no other day, you know, it's no other day. Right. It's a, I do what I'm told. They call me, I go. If they don't call me, I sit. You get my point? That's how I roll. You sit me down for 6 weeks, I'll sit down for 6 weeks. If I really got something to say, I will ask you to speak. But you get the point I'm trying to make here. The point I'm trying to make is, it's just Sunday.
Right.
And when November 25th, and I love November 25th, 26th or 27th, when Thanksgiving comes, it's just Thursday.
Really?
That's the point I'm trying to make. But we put our flesh on it and make it more than what it is. We don't want to do that on a day like today. You just might have to do that today. You get my point? To make a point. Now, that's enough for that. Now, I call Romans 1:19 and 20. I ain't got nowhere, folks. I apologize. But read on, please.
You don't got a whole lot of places.
Read, please.
Because that which may be known of Yahweh is manifest in them.
Now look, because that which may be known of Yahweh is manifest in them. I'm going to say it again. Because that which may be known of Yahweh is manifest in them.
Right.
You ain't going to know everything about Yahweh. You know something for an assurity.
Yeah.
Whereby you're not guessing and speculating about your creator. And when somebody walk in here with a collar turned back, you ain't all shaking in your boots and scared about what he going to say.
Mm-hmm.
You see? Because I guarantee he has no idea what he coming up against.
Really?
You see? And okay, how many letters behind your name? Because that which may be known on Yahweh is manifest in them. Them who? The man himself. You are a witness that there is a creator. Because you are a creature, and if there's a creature, there have to be a creator. You got a creator, you got a creation, and you are the creature made manifest. You see? And everything the creature does is going to be a reflection of the Father. You see, the creation is just going to be a reflection of the Father. Everything has to be threefold, and it has to manifest and reflect Him, including you. You see, now read, please.
For Yahweh has showed it unto them.
Go ahead, please.
For the invisible things of Him from the creation of the world are clearly seen.
Read.
Being understood by the things that are made.
Mm-hmm.
Even His eternal power and supernal nature, so that they are without excuse.
Now, there's no reason why you should not know your Creator as He really is and as He actually exists.
That's right.
Because the witnesses have been given to you. So we already talked about Yahweh's threefold. He's the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Now, in Adam, the smallest particle of non-living matter is a proton, neutron, electron. But it is one atom. Why? Because they have to reflect the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and these three is one. The smallest particle of living matter is a cell. It has a nucleus, a nucleus, and a cell body. Why? To reflect the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and these three are one. The earth is the cord, the cross, and the mantle. Why? To reflect the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. You speak past, present, and future. Why? Because in no other way, it has to reflect the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. These three are one. There's one language. Either right side up, upside down, or sideways. No other way to reflect the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Why are things that way? Everything must reflect Yahweh Himself. The whole creation is screaming His name to take away any excuse that you have about a creator. The problem is that you are absorbed, like the Borg. You absorb into the world.
Right.
And when you get absorbed into the world, you function like the world.
Right.
And they know how to grab your attention to take your mind off Yahweh. With sports, with entertainment. And you get my point? All this stuff where you can't focus on what you need to focus on. You see? Sometimes this might be eating. Some folks just eat themselves to death. You see that guy with 900 pounds? Who get 900 pounds? Who brings him that much food every day? 900 pounds? I'm not sure if I want a kid 900 pounds. Maybe not even 7. I have a hard time dealing with myself. I'm 200. Look at all the stuff they got on me here. I had to change 3 pants today just to get in these. You get my image, you know. But you get the point I'm trying to make. Let's read. Wait. I don't want to hit that yet. My point is, everything is threefold. Now, you take these charts. Each one of these plates are the same thing. 1, 2, 3. We call them plates because you eat off of them. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. Everything is a reflection of Yahweh Elohim Himself, showing forth the threefold makeup, you see, of Yahweh. the tabernacle. You see, they have the most holy place, the holy place in the court round about, but it's one tabernacle. The ark has an upper deck, a middle deck, and a lower deck, but it's one ark. Solomon's temple has the porch, the oracle, and the sanctuary, but it's one temple. Everything must reflect him. All right? Now, this tabernacle, I want to say something about that as we're moving forward. Let's pick it up real quick, the 24th chapter of Exodus, and just let me hit that, and then I want to make sure I talk about the Passover Supper, because that's what I'm going to close out with. All
right? Exodus 24:9. Then went up Moses and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel.
Read on.
And they saw the Elohim of Israel.
Read, they saw God. Read.
And there was under his feet, as it were, a peak work of sapphire stone.
That's the earth. Read.
And it, as it were, the body of heaven in its clearness. And upon the nobles of the children of Israel, he laid not his hand.
Now we know now that God has feet, he has body, he has a body, and he has hands. Look at something almost like a man. So when Moses writes the Genesis as he comes down after 40 days, he sees the man, and he sees Elohim, and he says the man is made in his image after his likeness. That's how he was able to write that, all right, when he was caught up in the mount. Nevertheless, he's caught up on the mount, and he's blacked out right here, you see, and the man was made to know. I said he was made to know how the creation was a symbol or came in by a pattern. Right. Keep reading, please.
And they saw Elohim and did eat and drink.
Read on. Now read on. They saw the shape of form. Read on.
And Yahweh Elohim said unto Moses, Come up to me into the mount and be there. And I will give thee tables of stone.
Read on.
And a law and commandments which I have written.
Go ahead.
That thou mayest teach them.
Go ahead.
And Moses rose up. And his minister, Joshua.
Joshua. Now here's Joshua. Now some people say, was his name Joshua? His name was Joshua. Mm-hmm. I made a comment the other day. That there was more than one person named Joshua. There he is right there.
Right.
Way back there in the law. You see? So when he comes along and they say, don't call him Joshua. No. They called him Joshua. Don't call me Joshua, the Messiah, Yahweh's anointed. Because then they're going to seek to kill me. Right. I ain't ready for that yet. But he's not the only one. Talk about this one, their name was Joshua. He was Joshua way back, even though they're the same ones.
Right.
All right?
Yeah.
Now, let's read him. Keep reading.
And Moses went up into the Mount of Elohim. And he said unto the elders, tarry ye here for us until we come unto you
again. Go ahead, read.
And behold, Aaron and Hur are with you.
Now, he's going to call Moses up in the mount. Now, keep this in mind. There's the base of the mount. There's the plateau of the mount.
Yeah.
And then there's the top of the mount.
Right.
Yeah. Showing forth to Yahweh's threefold.
Right.
I'm just laying it out for you.
Mm-hmm.
You see? Then he had the man who is threefold. You see? Moses, the head chest, of course, of Dharma region, who's coming up in the mountain. Now, you got Joshua, son of Nun, who is Yahweh Elohim, made manifest. And then you got Moses with the Holy Spirit. Those two are going up as the witnesses to Yahweh. You see? Elohim and Joshua going up at the mountain. And he's going to see a rerun of the creation, how it comes in, that is, by the pattern. But when Moses is up here, he sees Yahweh Elohim transformed into the threefold completely furnished tabernacle, having nine vessels, you see, in three compartments. In the most holy place, there's three vessels. There are three vessels in the holy place, and there are three vessels in the court around about. 25th. Pick up real quick. Keep reading real quick, and then I'm going to have you jump down to 25 and 8.
If any man has any matters to do, let him come unto them.
Keep reading.
And Moses went up into the mount, and a cloud covered the mount. And the glory of Yahweh abode upon Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered it 6 days.
Now, cooling. The glory of Yahweh is not a cloud. The glory of Yahweh is Yahweh Elohim. That's the glory of Yahweh that was atop Mount Sinai. All right? Now, you see a colon here. When you see the colon, what the colon means, there should be an explanation about the previous statement. Read, please.
And the seventh day.
Don't say squat about no doggone 6 days. That does it.
No.
It starts talking about the seventh day.
Right.
Now the question is, where are those 6 days?
Mm-hmm.
This is where the Genesis started. somebody pick up Genesis 1:1. I want you to read that again and then start reading the Genesis. Okay? And I'll tell you to stop to read the seventh day.
And the glory of Yahweh abode upon Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered it 6 days.
Read.
In the beginning, Elohim created the heavens and the earth.
Now he started talking about the 6 days. Read.
And the earth became without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep.
So Moses is saying, as I was caught up in the midst of the cloud, Yahweh blacked me out. You see? And in the beginning, you see, Yahweh, I saw how Yahweh created the heavens and the earth. Mm-hmm. And the earth as I knew it, it became without form and void. Just like when you go to sleep at night.
Right. Mm-hmm.
The earth as you know it becomes without form and void. Is that right?
Right.
You don't feel your body, the earth, you don't nothing until you wake up the next day.
Mm-hmm.
All right? Read, please.
And the spirit of Elohim moved upon the face of the waters.
Now, you're still alive because the spirit of Elohim is still upon that body. All right? Let's read.
And Elohim said, let there be light, and there was light.
That's good enough right there. My point is, the Genesis belongs right here.
Mm-hmm.
All right? That's where the Genesis starts. And then it goes on. I ain't got time to draw this out the way I want. But anyway, that's the point I want to make. Now, Moses seen the creation in 6 days, and he sees a rerun of the creation by way of a vision, how it was assembled by a pattern. And then on the seventh day, Yahweh Elohim rested. And then for the next 33 days, he sees and receives divine specifications on how to build, construct this tabernacle, having a most holy place, and a court around about. That's what Moses witnessed when he was in that mountain for a total of 40 days. And then he comes down out of the mountain, that's when he breaks the tables of stone, and then the tabernacle is built. Now this tabernacle, you see, it has a most holy place, a holy place, and a court around about. This is the pattern that we're talking about. You see, there's three vessels, you see, in the most holy place, because this is a three-in-one configuration. It has the mercy seat and the two archangels. You got Michael and you have Gabriel. You see, Michael's a warrior and Gabriel's a messenger. You see, and this is one pure beaten piece, you see, a vessel whereby the angels, their wings would overshadow the mercy seat and they would meet right up top in the middle. You see, and the mercy seat, you see, which the angel was standing up, there was just one beaten piece making up the throne of Yahweh. And there was a lid, or there was a cover here where they would go in and would put the tables of stones in the Ark of the Covenant, where Aaron's rod had budded, and also there was a pot of manna that was in the midst of the Ark here. Alright? Nevertheless, that is the seventh step, you see, or the most holy place. Now, your brain is made first, right?
Right.
You see? So therefore, the Ark of the Covenant had to be made first.
Mm-hmm.
Coming down out of here, you see, you have a second a veil that would cover, you see, the most holy place, separating the holy place, the holy place from the most holy place, because you couldn't see inside. Just like your brain have a skull or a cranium that covers your brain. You see? That's like into your veil. And coming on down here, You have the altar of incense. Now let me say this. This veil is blue, purple, and scarlet.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Which, like into the first veil, is also blue, purple, and scarlet. The altar of incense is where the high priest would make the incense out of four ingredients. Okay? One of them is called frankincense, galbanum, astaxanthin, and onycha. Okay? Those are the four ingredients, but only the high priest knew the composition.
Mm-hmm.
Of the incense that would walk up into the most holy place to prevent the animals from prevent Yahweh from smelling the stench of the animals that was burning down here on the altar. Okay? Then you have the seven branch golden lampstand, which is likened to your aorta in your heart here. You see, there are seven branches, and the fourth branch, the high priest, of course, would fill it with oil, pure beaten oil, you see, and it would fill evenly, you see, which points to the 7 days of creation. Then you have a table of shewbread, which 12 loaves of bread was on top of this table of shewbread, 6 on one side, 6 on the other, representing 12 tribes of Israel. It also points to your heart, which you have a four-chambered heart here. You see, right, left auricle, right, left ventricle. And there was a crown that went around this table of shewbread. Also, you have a coronary artery that goes around your heart that feeds your heart. You have a seven-branch aortic arch, so therefore you have a seven-branch lampstand. And let me tell you this. The seven-branch aortic arch is pumped oxygenated blood. You have oxygenated blood and deoxygenated blood. Deoxygenated blood means that blood, that oxygen has been dropped off. When the blood leaves the heart, it picks up oxygen, it comes back to the heart, and then goes to the rest part of your body. And then it feeds the whole body and finds its way back to, of course, the right atrium up here. Okay? So it lines up, of course, to your table of shewbread. And then there's a door here, which lines up, of course, to your diaphragm, which is 3 centimeters thick. This is 3 feet wide. And coming on at the door, you see the cup of holy anointing oil, which of course lines in with your adrenal glands, which are on top of your kidneys. Now you have a laver here, you see, for the washing to take place. You're going to have to wash the animal, and the high priest also had to be washed as well. Just like when you eat your animals, whatever it is, it has to be cleansed in your blood. And on top of your kidneys is the adrenal gland, which you call the flight or fright syndrome, where it produces adrenaline. Okay, and that adrenaline gives you energy you never thought you had. Some women say they can pick up a Volkswagen when they see their child trapped under, or you get an extra burst of speed because of fright, or you're scared or something like that. But that's what that is, a quickening. That's the point I'm trying to make. Because this cup of holy anointing oil had pure bean oil, and he had to pour that on his head before he can officiate in the holy place and the most holy place. That was at the door. And then, of course, the Ark of the Covenant, which is, the altar of sin sacrifice, which the sacrifice was placed on, you see, which it had four horns on it, and the high priest would take the blood of the sacrifice and put it in the four horns of the altar, representing the earth, okay? Now, I said all that to say what I'm getting ready to say now. Now, the earth, you see, has latitude, and it has longitude, right? Mm-hmm. You see, and then there's people on the earth, right? Mm-hmm. We are that sacrifice on the earth, all right? Likewise, Yahweh prepared his own sacrifice, which is Yahshua the Messiah himself, because there was no acceptable sacrifice on the earth that can atone for mankind's sins. You see, they put the turtle dove, the rams, and the pigeons, you see, and the first fruits of the ground on the altar, you see, but none of these were acceptable sacrifices that can atone for our sins. Therefore, Yahweh created his own sacrifice, which is Yahshua Messiah, to come in, you see, to atone for mankind's sins. Now, Christianity teaches, nothing like this. They don't know how he got up out of the ground from Friday to Sunday, which is what I'm going to talk about right now. They go back to Wednesday, or they go back to Thursday. But what we prove down here, you got to prove it by the scriptures. Remember, the scriptures is the law and the prophets. Yeah. You see, so you got to go back to the scriptures and look for his death, his burial, and his resurrection, because that's the definition of the gospel. So let's pick it up real quick. Matthew 27, and I think I want 39, maybe even 38. And we're going to pick up these scriptures. You're going to pick up Zechariah 14 and 6, Amos 8 and 9, and we're getting ready to get Matthew 27 and 38.
Matthew 27
and 38. Now this is how he was on the cross for 3 days and 3 nights from Friday to Sunday. Now some folks say you can't get 3 days from Friday to Sunday. That's true, the way you're looking at it. You're looking at it with a carnal mind, all right? Let's read, please.
Then were there two thieves crucified with him, one on the right hand and another on the left.
Read.
And they that passed by reviled him,
read,
wagging their heads and saying, Thou that destroyeth the temple and buildest it in 3 days, save thyself.
So they're mocking him, because he said destroy this temple, not raise it in 3 days. Mm-hmm. And what happened was, they were building the Herodian temple at that time, which was 46 years in the building. And he said, destroy this temple, not raise it in three days. He was never talking about that temple, he was talking about his body. You understand? And I'll say it this way, we can move on. In order for you to have an egg, all right, called an ovum, right? There's 23 chromosomes from the male, and there's 23 chromosomes, of course, from the female. That makes up 46 chromosomes, which makes up you. All right? So destroy this temple, and I raise it up in 3 days. Let's read, please.
If thou be the son of Yahweh, come down from the cross.
Go ahead, read on, please.
Likewise, also the chief priests mocking with the scribes and elders said, he save others. Himself he cannot save.
Read.
If he be the king of Israel, let him now come down from the cross, and we will believe him.
So they didn't believe he was who he said he was, even though he was healing the sick, called the blind to see, the dumb to speak, and the deaf to hear. They didn't believe that he was Yahweh in the body. Let's read, please.
He trusted in Yahweh.
Read.
Let him deliver himself now.
Go ahead.
If he will have him, for he said, I am the son of Yahweh.
Read.
The thieves also, which were crucified with him, cast the same in his teeth.
Mm-hmm.
Now, from the sixth hour, there was darkness over the land until the ninth hour.
Now, from sixth to the ninth hour, there was darkness. All right? I want you to stay where you are. I want you to pick up John 19:30. And just read it when you get it. Now.
John 19:30.
Now, let me say this. When you're talking about time, Hebrew time, their time started the first day. We call it 6 o'clock in the morning. They call it the first hour. So they got the first hour, the second hour, the third hour, the fourth hour, the fifth hour, and the sixth hour. Okay. So from 6 o'clock to 7 o'clock, that equals 1 hour. From 7 o'clock to 8 o'clock, that's 2 hours. From 8 o'clock to 9 o'clock, that's 3. You get my point?
Right.
All the way down. So you're going to see, by the time you get here, you're going to have 11 o'clock to 12 o'clock, that's the 6 hour. Do you see that?
Right.
All right, coming all the way down. That's Hebrew time,
yeah.
Not for new Gregorian calendar, which we're on. So they always talk about the first hour and second hour. So on the day of Pentecost, they say these people are supposed to be drunk. It ain't but the third hour of the day. Talking about it's 9 o'clock.
Right.
All right. So they're saying it turned dark from the sixth to the ninth hour. So from the sixth to the ninth hour, that would be 12 o'clock, right?
Mm-hmm.
Our time. I'm ready right there, time. Let me have that black marker over there because I think I'd be better off with that. So it turned dark from the sixth. Sixth to the ninth hour, which is 12 o'clock our time to 3 o'clock their time. All right? That's p.m. All right? It turned dark from the sixth to the ninth hour. Right?
Yeah.
Now, pick up Zechariah 14 and 6. And Amos 8 and 9.
Zechariah 14:9.
And that was Friday. Read on.
Zechariah 14:6.
Mm-hmm.
And it shall come to pass in that day that the light shall not be clear in some places and dark in other places of the world.
Hold it. Go ahead.
But it shall be one day which shall be known to Yahweh, not day nor night. But it shall come to pass that at evening time it shall be light. And it shall be in that day that living waters shall go out from Jerusalem, and half of them towards the eastern, and half of them towards the western
That's
sea.
That's good enough right there. Now read quickly Amos 8 and 9.
Amos 8 and 9.
Mm-hmm.
And it will come to pass in that day, saith Yahweh, I will cause the sun to go down at noon,
mm-hmm.
and I will darken the earth in the clear day.
Okay, now go back to Zechariah. I want to make a point because I'm writing over here.
9. Zechariah 9? Are you beginning?
No, 6.
6. And it came to pass in that day that the light shall not be clear in some places, mm-hmm. and dark in other places of the world.
Read.
But it shall be one day which shall be known to Yahweh.
That's what I want. It's going to be a day only known to Yahweh. So, from 6 o'clock in the morning to 9 o'clock, and they put him on the cross at 9 o'clock. So, from 6 o'clock to 12 o'clock, it was daylight. Mm-hmm. You see? And then it said it turned dark from the 6th to the 9th hour. So, from 12 o'clock, our time, to 3 o'clock, which is the 6th and 9th hour, it was dark. Mm-hmm. And also, the book says it's going to turn back light again in the clear day. Did you hear what it says?
Yes, sir.
You see? And that's going to be from 3 o'clock to 6 o'clock. You see, it's going to be day again, right? And then, from 6 o'clock in the evening on Friday, p.m., on around to 6 o'clock the next morning, of course, there was darkness. This is what we call the phenomenal day. There was 2 days and 2 nights in 1 day. Because the scriptures prophesied what's going to happen when the Messiah manifests on the earth plane. And then it says, and it was finished. You read John 19?
Oh.
19:30.
When Yahshua therefore had received the vinegar, he said, it is finished. And he bowed his head and expired.
Okay, that was at 12 o'clock. Okay?
Right.
So, it turned dark. That is, from the 6th to the 9th hour. And then it turned back light again at 3 o'clock to 6 o'clock. And then, of course, it turned from 6 o'clock on around to 6 o'clock in the morning. It was dark. Now, on Saturday, okay, morning, from 6 o'clock a.m. To 6 o'clock p.m., of course, it was day, right? And then Saturday at 6 o'clock p.m. around to the next morning, he resurrected, right? Did I say that right? So you got 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. 3 days and 3 nights. Now, Genesis 1 and 1. Now the question is, how do you get that? Because if you look at it from a 24-hour point of view, it ain't going to work. You ain't going to get it. You got to look at it the way Yahweh is looking at it, all right, when he talks about time. We'll talk about that in a few minutes, a little bit more in a second. Let's read, please.
In the beginning, Elohim created the heavens and the earth.
Read.
And the earth was without form and void.
Read.
And darkness was upon the face of the deep.
Read.
And the spirit of Elohim moved upon the face of the waters.
Uh-huh.
And Elohim said, let there be light.
Uh-huh.
And there was light.
Now he said, let there be light, and there was light, right? Read.
And Elohim saw the light.
Uh-huh.
That it was good.
Read.
And Elohim divided between the light and between the darkness.
Uh-huh.
And Elohim called the light day.
Yahweh called the light day. Read on.
And the darkness he called night.
And the darkness he called night. So when Yahweh sees light, he calls it day.
Yes.
And when Yahweh sees darkness, he calls it night.
Okay.
You see, as far as he is concerned, not what you think.
Right.
You see, because Yahweh does not operate or vibe within the realm of time. Nevertheless, time begins and ends within the realm of eternity. Does that make sense? But Yahweh himself does not abide within the realm of time. So when he sees light, you see, he calls it, I'll do it this way, I'll call it night. Alright? And then when he sees, I probably should have done it this way. This is night. And we'll call this night. That makes sense?
Absolutely.
Now, that's how you're going to get 3 days and 3 nights without going back to Thursday or Wednesday. Now, if anybody want to argue with me about that, you're welcome. Alright? Now, or you bring somebody else one and disprove it. Now, I want to make another thing about time, since we're talking about time. Real quickly, pick up Numbers 34 and 14, and then pick up 2 Peter 3 and 8. Now, we got a pattern here, right?
talk about time. All right? You have eternity. You have creative time. And then you have prophetic time. All right? Now, when you talk about prophetic time, read it, Numbers 14 and 6. 34:14.
Numbers 34 and 14. For the tribe of the children of Reuben, according to the house of their father.
Did I say Numbers 34:14?
Yes, you did.
Okay, go ahead.
For the tribe of the children of Reuben, according to the house of their fathers. And the tribe of the children of Gad.
14:34.
After the number of the days in which he surveyed the land, even 40 days, each day for a year, shall ye bear your iniquities.
Now he's letting you know, the children of Israel, after they came up on the land of Egypt, they were supposed to stay out there for 40 days. But because of their disobedience, they're out there for 40 years. Mm-hmm. So that's a day for a year, prophetically speaking. Right. You with me so far? Mm-hmm. So, now, then there's creative time. Read.
After the number of the days in which ye have surveyed the land.
Second Peter, 3:8.
2 Peter 3:8. But beloved, be not ignorant of this one thing.
Read.
That one day is with Yahweh as 1,000 years.
Yes.
And 1,000 years as one day.
Now look, we got the ages and dispensation chart. We got 7 ages. We have 7 dispensations. What is an age? An age is synonymous to the word world. A war is approximately 2,000 years. Now, this is the age before the flood, which is called the antediluvian flood. The word diluvian means flood. So this is the age before the flood. So from the fall of Adam all the way down to the flood, that's called the antediluvian age, which lasted for 1,656 years. Right. Then there's post-diluvian, the age after the flood, because post means after. So this is the age after the flood, which ended at the cross. That's 2,377 years, which ended, of course, at the cross. Now, where you're sitting at right now is the present kingdom age. That's where we're sitting. So, and then of course you got ages to come. You see, so you got 7 ages or 7 worlds, and you got 7 dispensations. A dispensation is a divine order of affairs. It is a period of time within a world. So, you got one day here, a day here, a day here, a day here. So you got 1, 2, 3, 4. Adam was the Adamic dispensation. Noah was the Noahic dispensation. Abraham was the 3rd dispensation, of course, with Melchizedek. Then Yahshua Messiah, or the Mosaic dispensation, started with Moses, you see, which ended at the cross. That's the 4th day. So when Yahshua Messiah came in fulfillment, Moses prophesied about him, and the prophets prophesied him, so he had to show up in the 4,000 year or on the 4th day. Okay, that is creative time. So we go and look at the creation coming in. You see how the creation comes in 7 days, right? Or in 6 days, and then Yahweh enters his rest. So you got here creation by the pattern. So that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and then Yahweh entered his rest, which is the 7th day or the Sabbath, which you got the Sabbath of immortality, of course, right here. All right? That's what that is. You see, the Sabbath of immortality, that's the 7th day. That is creative times. All right? Then you have eternity. Genesis 2. King James Version is 2 and 4. Holy Name Version is 2 and 1. But when you read that, that's the day of Yahweh. Read.
Genesis 2 and 4.
Read.
And Yahweh Elohim formed man of the dust of the ground.
No, that's you and Holy Name. 2 and 1 for you. King James, okay. 2 and 4.
These are the origins of the heavens and of the earth.
Read.
When they were created in the day that Yahweh Elohim made the earth.
Now, go ahead. Now go back and read that again. but don't read over it.
Wait.
It's the day, because that's the emphasis I want you to put on there. But when you just read it as a day, folks don't get that.
Okay.
They think you're talking like a Snickers bar or something like that. But they just read over it, don't even see it. But when you say in the day, I got that. Okay. So, we're hoping.
These are the origins of the heaven and of the earth when they were created. In the day that Yahweh Elohim made the earth.
Now the question is, what is the day? That is the day of eternity. Got it right here on the chart. Alright? Eternity is a consciousness. Eternity is here. You see, this is where eternity is. It's right within your consciousness. When you sleep and you start dreaming, you start seeing things, right? And the first thing you see is light, correct? Then you know you're on the other side of creation, okay? Now, in that state, you're not conscious of the earthly realm and not even your physical body. Sometimes it's so real, you find out when you wake up, it was a dream, right? And you're happy about that because you see things in that dream. My point is, that's the realm of eternity. And we leave from our bodies coming from a corporeal into an incorporeal state. And as we waken up, we put our bodies back on, moving from the incorporeal into the corporeal. But when you're in that state of sleep, I'm talking about deep REM sleep, it is as if you don't exist, right? That is about the closest place you're gonna get to pure spirit, abstractness. The only reason you know you exist is because you woke up the next day and looked at the clock. And sometimes you don't know if you slept 1 hour, 2 hours, or 10 hours until you looked at the clock. Is that all right? Mm-hmm. Now, I'm going to say something else. Since I'm here, before we get out of here, go back to Romans 1:19 and 20. Now, talking about heaven. Matter of fact, screw that. Forget that. I apologize. Go to 2 Corinthians, who was in this the other night. 2 Corinthians, the 12th chapter, and just read down to the 4th.
2 Corinthians 12 and 1.
Because I want to make a point.
It is not expedient for me, doubtless, to glory.
Mm-hmm.
I will come to visions and revelations of Yahweh.
Read on.
I knew a man in the Messiah more than 14 years ago. Whether in the body, I cannot tell. Or whether out of the body, I cannot tell.
Mm-hmm.
Yahweh knoweth. Such a one caught up to the third heaven.
Caught up to the third heaven. Okay, go ahead.
And I knew such a man, whether in the body or out of the body, I cannot tell.
Uh-huh.
Yahweh knoweth.
Only Yahweh knoweth. Go ahead.
How that he was caught up into glory and heard unspeakable words, which is not possible for a man to utter.
That's good enough right there. So we got space, we got the atmospherical heavens, and then we have eternity. All right? Now, I'm going to put that right there. And I'm going to put that to heavens. And then you have water. Right? It's in a gas state, a liquid state, and a solid state. Right? You got gas, right? You got liquid, right? Then you got a... I better do it like this here. And then I'll make my point. Now, you got a glass. It takes on the shape and form of the container, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then you got the same container, right? It goes into a solid, right? If you put it in some ice.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I said all that to say this. Everything abides within the realm of eternity, you see? And I'm trying to show you right now how that there's three heavens. I didn't find out there was three heavens until I came down here.
Mm-hmm.
And to be really honest with you, I didn't believe and know where heaven was. I just believed what everybody told me. It was above the sun, moon, and stars. Mm-hmm. I just believed that because they said it, I felt like they should know. Then I found out there was three heavens. You see, and then I found out that there was a hell too. Now, you got space. The earth is suspended in space like a ball, right? You see, that's the first heaven. You're standing on it. So nobody will be disappointed. When you die, mm-hmm. we're going to put you in the ground, and you can go to heaven. So you'll be happy to say you got there. Heaven. It's earth. That's the first heaven. You're standing on the first heaven. Mm-hmm. Now, the atmospherical heaven, of course, the book says this. Y'all, we carry the heavens and the earth, right? Mm-hmm. What heavens are you talking about? Where the birds fly, right? Mm-hmm. That's what he's talking about. Those are the heavens. And how we talking about soaring into the heavens, right? Mm-hmm. That is the atmospherical heaven, all right? And then we got eternity, which is a state, a condition, or a consciousness.
Yeah.
That's within here. Now, you and everything else, space and all things therein, and the atmosphere, they emanate from the third, which is eternity.
Right.
All right? Mm-hmm. Now, some people don't believe that. But then you got gas. We know that there's the air is likened to a gaseous state, right? Mm-hmm. Now, you don't see no water in the room now, do you?
Yeah.
Unless it's in that little container right there, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now, when it condenses, when it transitions, when it goes through the veil, right?
Yes, sir.
Right? Lower than 212 degrees
yes, sir.
Fahrenheit, right?
Yeah.
Because we have a second departmental veil, you have to see a change when the transition takes place.
Mm-hmm.
So therefore, it's in a liquid state as it rains, and it is a container, it collects, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then you take that same container and put it in the freezer, or if it just freezes below 33 degrees, right?
Mm-hmm.
We got ice.
Right.
What am I saying? I'm saying the solid and the liquid emanates from the gas.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Then you should have be able to see how that the earth and the atmosphere emanates from the realm of eternity.
Right.
Because the principle is the same, but the manifestation changes. So therefore, you got eternity, you got the creative state, you got prophetic time, talking about time. I said all that to say this, and I'm going to sit down. Is that what we're trying to do right now is to elevate you into the realm of eternity, whereby there is a consciousness and awareness of the spirit of the living Elohim in you. And when you get into the realm of eternity, then you will not look at things the same way you do now. When you see a tree, it's not going to just be there to give you a suntan. You're going to to give you shade. You're going to realize that the tree points back to the man,
right.
Which points back to Yahweh Elohim, who is the tree of life. You follow what I'm saying? Which is in you, and that's where you're going to get all your strength, all your resources, all your knowledge, and your understanding is within him. It's him and only him that can teach and lead you. Hallelujah.
Good job.
Well, to truly thank the Father for allowing us to hold class this morning. And we hold classes every Tuesday and Friday from 7:30 to 9:30. Sunday mornings from 11 to 1. The fourth Sunday of every month, we have a Spanish class from 9:30 in the morning to 10:45. There will be no class this Friday and this Sunday. Class will resume. We'll have class Tuesday. Then the following week, we'll resume back class on that Tuesday. Taking a little break, the dean and the public relations director and the secretary is attending a thing in Chicago, so they won't be here. But we can handle it. I need a break. A lot of people need a break, so we'll be shutting down for a little while. So come back again and study with us. Bring your friends and all your enemies, and all donations will be accepted by our treasurer, Dr. Lloyd Lawless, and Stan for the doxology. Now to him that is able to keep you from falling and present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. to the only one Elohim, our Savior, through the gospel of the Messiah, our sovereign, belong glory, majesty, dominion, and power, for before all time, now and ever. Let us all say hallelujah. And if you want some ice cold lemonade, Minute Maid, I got some in there for you to drink. And it is good.
How are you doing, young man?
I'm good.
Is that true?
Okay.